you all for having us. I always get so nervous. I love singing, and I'm blessed to be able to sing with my family tonight. And this song, I made them learn it this week. This is a song my dad used to sing, me and my sister Tammy. And it's very special to me, and I didn't get to sing it for a long time until my sister started going to church with us a couple years ago, and we got to sing it a couple times, but after we practiced it, you know, I said, Papa would be so proud to know that we're still singing his songs that we sung 40 years ago, and the good ones never get old. So, you pray for us as we sing.
But someday when life here is over, Child and forever I That loneliness was something you'd miss.
about heaven. And this one's about trading what we got here for that. And this is not as good here. I don't know what they're doing with the book.
Thank you. privilege to gather in meeting to preach for Brother Frank. It is such an honor to have him and his dear wife here tonight. And we love them dearly in the Lord. I told Miss Brooke, when somebody said they thought Brother Frank pulled up, I said, this made my night. I get to see them, fellowship with them a little bit tonight. And we appreciate each one that's here tonight in this service. And I want a joy, hard to believe it's already Thursday night. Where's the week gone? And that's the way it is. Where life's going to be. Today and gone tomorrow. And as a vapor appears for a time and vanishes away. And I just want to make the best of my days for the glory of the Lord. And tonight I believe we have clear direction on what God wants. Won't you turn in your Bibles to Revelation chapter number 4? Revelation chapter 4, if you listen to the songs and the theme of the songs, and you know where I'm going tonight in the message. I pray the Lord will use it for the glory and honor of the Lord tonight. So let's stand on and read the God's Word, Revelation.
That is. It's a place that has walls of jasper, gates of pearl, and a shrine.
transparent, pure gold. We know God is there. We know the holy angels are there. We know tonight that the departed saints are there in the presence of God right now in this land called heaven. It's the land that I long for. It's the land that I look for. And one day it'll be the land that I live in by the good grace of God. And so I'm grateful for that. We know there's no sickness, there's no sin, and there's no suffering in this good and this glorious land that we're going to. It's a place, the Bible says, that the former things are going to pass away, and behold, all things are going to become new. When I think about our hope of heaven, we know that Jesus is on the way to heaven. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh of the Father but by me. You can't get to heaven through water baptism. You can't get to heaven through the wafer. And you can't get to heaven through your works. But I tell you right now, you can go to heaven through repentance toward God and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ to be your Lord and your Savior. And so I'm grateful that heaven is a prepared place for prepared people. That's the truth about heaven. There are many that think they are going to heaven, but the truth about heaven is found in 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9 through 10. Paul said, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves of mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. We live in a world today that everybody thinks they're going to go to heaven. I want to tell you the truth about heaven is you must be born again if you're going to see that good land and if you're going to enter into that good land in the by and by. And so I want to thank God for this heavenly land that we're looking at. As born again believers, the Bible teaches us to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And of course we know that He is in heaven right now. And so the moment we draw last final breath as a child of God, we'll be present in heaven's fair land. Hallelujah. And so, my friend, we need to understand this is the truth. Saved people go to heaven, and lost people go to a literal burning devil's hell. I'm glad that I'm saved, and I'm glad that my hope is beyond this life. I have a hope of that heavenly land that I'm going to. And I use the term hope tonight in the Bible. The term hope is not a guessing so or a thinking so. It is a confident expectation that what God has promised, He is able also to perform. And so I want to give you a few things about heaven today and our hope of heaven. Much of what people consider about heaven in this generation are simply just the carnal thoughts of a man's mind. You hear statements like this, well, we're going to drag race down glory, or we're going to fish in the river of life. And you hear those things, and the truth is none of those things are really so. But I do have a Bible tonight that reveals to me a glorious scene into heaven in Revelation chapter number 4. And so I don't want to just go on what people think heaven's going to be like. I want to see tonight the truth about heaven as it's revealed in the Word of God. Well, the first thing we can know about heaven surely tonight is in heaven we see the sovereign is there. Look at verse 2 and verse 3. John said, and immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone, and there was a rainbow round about the throne in sight like unto an emerald. And so the first thing John saw when he saw heaven, he saw the preeminence of God in that land. You see, how do you know that, Brother Tommy? Well, look, the Bible said the very first thing that John the Beloved saw is he beheld a throne was set in heaven. And so immediately we see a throne is in heaven. The throne speaks of God's supreme authority and absolute sovereignty. Hallelujah. I'm glad heaven is God's throne room. And so the center point of heaven is the throne of God and the Savior that sits upon the throne. I think it's clearly seen about heaven being God's throne room by the fact the word throne is found some 12 times.
sovereignty of God. I'm glad tonight he's still a God that has all power and all authority. Hallelujah. And so now I'm thinking about God tonight, the one that's in heaven. He's not a little God. He's the great I am tonight. And so he's sitting on the throne in that heavenly country, even as I'm preaching the word of God tonight. And one of these days, my eyes shall behold him, and not another, in the very presence of God in that heavenly country. And so thank God the sovereign and supreme God is in heaven. And so this speaks of the glorious government of God. It's the throne of the Almighty God of heaven. Amen. And so I'm thankful for that. It's interesting to note that the throne is also mentioned five times in Revelation chapter number 5. And of course in Bible numerology we know that number 5 is the number of grace. And so it's not only a throne of government, it's a throne of grace. Hallelujah. The same God that wrote the law is the same God that extended love to you and I as unworthy sinners. Isn't that amazing? The holy God of the universe is still the one that had a heart for us to save us and to set us free. And so when I think about heaven, it's all going to be about the preeminence of God. And somebody said, what's heaven going to be like? Well, I can tell you this. It's all going to be about him that suffered, bled, and died so we can be saved by God's amazing grace. And so the throne speaks of his preeminence being in heaven. And so my friend, we're in a world today that refuses to recognize him. We're in a world today that don't reverence him. Look, can I just tell you, everybody in heaven is recognizing him. Everybody in heaven is reverencing him. Everybody in heaven is responding to him and rejoicing in him tonight. And so I'm glad that that's our future as the saved children of God. Isn't it amazing tonight that it could be today? This could be the very hour that the trumpet of God sounds and the church will be called up to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And so tonight we see that the sovereign God is in heaven. Not only is his preeminence clearly seen, but the next thing that John beheld in heaven is he beheld the person of God. His person was there. He said, and one sat on the throne. As John peered in the glory world, he saw that God was on his throne. And I think in a very fitting fashion, the first person that John saw was the Lord. Amen. I will say this, when I get to heaven, I hope to find loved ones there. But before I see my loved ones there, the one I long to see above all others is the one that died for me and made a way that I could be saved and enter into that good land. And so when John enters into heaven in the Spirit of God, in this grand revelation that God is unfolding to him, he sees the throne, and thank God he sees the triumphant one, the God that's sitting upon the throne. Now I think it's quite interesting as we study the Word of God that so little is said concerning what he saw about the person of God. All he really does to describe him is a short little, if you will, just a short little line describing the magnificence of God. I'm going to say this unto you. I believe that God is so magnificent. I believe that he's so great that human words cannot adequately describe how great that he is and how glorious that he really is. I mean, I listen every time I preach about him. I wish I could tell the story a little better. I wish I could exalt him a little higher. I wish I could tell a little more plainer. But the reality is, human words are not adequate to describe the reality of what heaven is going to be like. I can tell you this, it's better than we've ever dreamed about. It's better than we've ever thought about. It's better than we've ever read about. And I'm glad it's home for you and I that are saved by the grace of God. Amen? And so we know that we'll see him when we leave this world. I believe it'll be true in our case, just as it was for John in this passage of Scripture. 2 Corinthians 5:8, Paul said, we are confident, I say, and will and rather be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. The Apostle Paul believed he would see the Lord when he drew life's final breath. He believed he'd be filled before anyone else. And so, I believe with all my heart to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. Back in Isaiah chapter 6, we find the prophet Isaiah caught a glimpse of the glory world and a glimpse of God upon his throne. And we know what happened to Isaiah when he saw the greatness of God. Isaiah took an inward look and he said, woe is me, for I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. completely as he saw how unworthy he was. And then he took a God, he took a Godward look. He beheld the Lord. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
When he beheld the Lord, he took a look inside and he saw his need. And then when he got his need fixed, he got an outward look and desire to go for God and serve the Lord. Yeah. You know what I want God to do in the message tonight? Well, I want him to encourage us and really say, by the grace of God, that heaven is our home. And we're just in a strange country right now. We're pilgrims and strangers passing through, headed toward the celestial city of God. And one day we're going to ride safe home by the grace of God in heaven's fair land. And so while we're here, let's don't get our 10 stakes too deep. There are two men that we understand the word of God. One was by the name of Abraham, and the other was by the name of Lot. Both of these men were saved. Both of them knew the Lord. But Abraham, he dwelled in tents, and he never got his 10 stakes too deep because he was looking for a country who had foundations, his builder and maker is God. He was looking for a better land. But his nephew Lot got in trouble, because he set his eyes toward the plains of Sodom. And the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye and the pride of life gripped his heart. And old Lot began to drift further toward the land of Sodom. And eventually he's dwelling in the city. He's sitting in the gate. He's become a resident of that land. And Lot's life ends in misery, but Abraham's life ends in majesty. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, you can make up your mind which way you're going to go. But if you're saved by the grace of God, I just want to take a first line ticket to the glory world. I want to fly first class. Amen. I want all the amenities.
Right.
I've been in the will of God, living for Him on my way to heaven. Amen. If you want to ride in the back of the plane and be, I mean, listen, and not have all the blessedness of it, that's your choice. But I'll tell you, friend, by the grace of God, I want what He's done for me on my journey to God's heaven. Amen.
Yeah.
So the person of God is seen. I think it's seen in Psalm 4:4. The Lord is in His holy temple. And then the Bible says this about the temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. And so where is the Lord's throne tonight? It's in heaven. And where are we going? We're going to heaven to be with Him one day after a while. Hallelujah. And so I praise His name. In verse 3, John said, and he that said was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. No doubt these rare gems are used to describe the beauty and the brilliance of our God. And so he's using something to try to talk about how great our God is. These stones were the first and the last stones on the breastplate of the priest in the Old Testament times. And so these stones were associated with the tribes of Reuben and the tribe of Benjamin. Now get this in mind. He bore those stones upon the breastplate, close to the heart of the priest. And as the people of God were close to his heart as he ministered in the tabernacle in those days. And can I just tell you, the earthly tabernacle is a picture of the heavenly tabernacle. And we have a high priest that's entered into heaven for us, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And he's appeared in the presence of God for us tonight as our advocate and our high priest. And I bless his good name tonight. And in heaven right now, there's somebody that is representing me that has been close to his heart in heaven, the Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't that a blessing? See, there's somebody praying for me tonight as I preach. Did you know that? Hey, there's somebody in heaven praying for me tonight as I serve the Lord and as I go through the journey. But that's not just exclusive for me. That's for every one of you that are truly saved by the grace of God. He's not praying for the lost world. He's praying for those that he has redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. He died for the world, but he prays for his people. Tonight we have a high priest praying for us in heaven. Isn't that a great blessing to consider? Amen. John described the scene here by saying there was a rainbow round about the throne in sight like unto an emerald. The rainbow being in a circle here symbolizes perfection. The rainbow is used in connection with God's covenant. And we know this green is the color of life, the evergreen. God's life is eternal in nature. Its duration is never ending. Is that not a blessing? And so we're talking about a city where we're going to have never-ending life. Hallelujah. If we're saved by the grace of God, we already have never-ending life inside our bodies. But one day after a while, body, soul, and spirit, we're going to have everlasting life in the presence of God in the glory world. consider that when you think about heaven, He is there. We know God's life and His lordship is never going to end. Isn't that wonderful?
Right.
You see, we need to get our affection set on things above and not on things of the earth. I'm afraid a lot of Christian people today have spent little time thinking about heaven, too much time thinking about this world here below. We're in the world, but thank God we're not of the world. He saved us for that heavenly land. And so in heaven we see the sovereign is there. But can I tell you what else John saw when he looked into heaven? Number two, in heaven we see the saints are there. Look in verse 4, and round about the throne were 24 and 26. And upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. We see their seats are mentioned in the passage of Scripture. Verse 4, and round about the throne were 24 and 26. And so there's one throne in heaven that is supreme and preeminent above all thrones, and that's the throne of God. But around that throne there are 24 and 26, according to the word of God, that are surrounding the throne of God. These seats in heaven are special seats. They're 24 in number. I like doing the studies of numbers in the Bible. And we know that God has granted these seats for a special people. We see they're sitting. They're seats, but then there's a sitting there. Upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting. There are 24 elders sitting on these seats. And I believe they are representative of the New Testament church, the bride of Christ. And there's some reasons why I believe that we can glean their identity in studying the Word of God line upon line and precept upon precept. Now, if you disagree with me, and I will disagree, and love will go on, I'm going to give you the reasons why I believe this is the New Testament church that's in heaven. Let me give you a few thoughts, and you consider these in your mind and see if this makes sense to you tonight. Number one, they are seen resting, and they are seen rejoicing. What are the people that are saved by grace and have died and gone on to heaven doing right now? Well, they're resting because the debt has been paid. The sin debt has been paid in full. There's nothing to be laid to their account. They are forever free, forevermore. And so thank God they're resting in the presence of God. And they're rejoicing in the presence of God as well. Their identity is clearly seen in the fact that they are called by the name elder. And this term is never given to an angel in the teaching of the Word of God. And so in the text we know this is a reference to the elder. And so I believe it's a reference to the New Testament church. Yet again, another truth that I'd like to lay before you, and I think helps us understand, is when we look in this text, they're wearing crowns. And did you know New Testament church age believers are promised crowns for their service unto the Lord? There are things like a crown of rejoicing and a crown of righteousness, the elder, the pastor's crown. There are five in number that are mentioned in the Word of God that are promises and pledges to those who are faithful to their service unto the Lord. One day I say, when He gives us the crowns that we have earned and are worked for God, we're going to cast all those crowns at the feet of Him that loved us and gave Himself for us, and we'll give Him all the glory. Amen. And so we understand these crowns are promised for Christian service. Now I'm going to say this while I'm there, and I'll move on. Every sinner that goes to heaven is going to be there by the unmerited, undeserved favor of God. It's by grace that any of us are going to heaven. But when it comes to your rewards are going to be based on your stewardship. You're not going to earn any reward in heaven that you didn't earn in your life here in serving the Lord and walking with Him. Amen. Your stewardship and your service are separate from your salvation and your position in Christ. Amen. Why should we live for God? Well, because there's going to be a day we're all going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account of ourselves unto God. And listen, at that day, we're all going to give an account of each other body, whether they be good or whether they be evil. He paid for our sin on the cross. He said of the sin debt, but our stewardship will be met again at the throne judgment of God when we stand there at the judgment seat of Christ. Amen. So, crowns are promised. What about this? The Bible speaks about how He's made us kings and priests unto our God. How many believe the New Testament church churches, kings, and priests unto God, according to the teaching of the Word of God. We are a holy priesthood, according to the Scripture. And so all these things, bearing in mind, would let us see that these 24 elders are the church of the living God. And we see these crowns in heaven are not earthly crowns, but they are crowns rewarded to saints at the judgment seat of Christ. In Revelation chapter 5, they have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Who's been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb? Well, I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And if you're saved by the grace of God, you have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I've got preacher friends that have done made the cross. People like Brother Carl Wilson. I love that man of God. What a great preacher he was. Hey, I'm telling you, one day I'm going to see him again on the other side. Because they have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Isn't that a blessing? Well, let me give you this too. I love studying Numbers 24. The number 24 speaks of God's appointments in worship. Let me illustrate that for you by giving you some Bible truths. When you go back to the earthly temple, there were 24,000 Levites that were appointed to that service in the temple. According to 1 Chronicles 23, verse 3 through 4, the priestly service was divided into 24 courses. According to 1 Chronicles 24 and chapter 25, there were 24 porters appointed to the temple worship in 1 Chronicles 26, 17 through 19. And so as I think about this number 24, I think it is giving us an indication of what we are going to be doing when we get to heaven. We're going to be worshiping Him. We have an appointment to worship Him. One day I'll preach my last sermon, but I'm never going to sing my last song. I say hallelujah to the Lamb tonight. What a happy time it's going to be in heaven's jubilee. Amen. I'm glad it's real tonight. Amen. Anybody else believe heaven's real?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Anybody else excited to get to go by the good grace of God? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hey, look at what the Bible says in verse 10 and 11. And it's going to bear out before us. These 24 elders fall down before Him that sit on the throne and worship Him that liveth. Now look how long they do it. Forever and forever. And cast their crowns before the throne, saying, sometimes I get my church and I'll say, everybody, repeat after me. And we're repeat verse 11 again, and I'll say we're just practicing up for heaven. Amen. Look what they say in heaven. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. I am a fundamentalist. I believe the Bible literally in its entirety. I believe every word of that Bible. I may not understand it all, but I believe it all. You say, preacher, do you literally believe that there's going to come a time in heaven that we are going to be saying, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created? I believe we're going to say those words literally and exactly as the Word of God says we will. That's how much I believe heaven's real. What a time that's going to be when the saints of God are worshiping in heaven. Amen. Anybody glad that your departed loved ones that were saved are present with God right now?
Yeah.
I'm so thankful that heaven's real and heaven's for the redeemed. Well, number three, in heaven, there's some sights that are revealed in this text. And so let's look at those for just a moment. What about heaven? What is heaven really like? Well, what heaven's really like is not what Hollywood wants you to think heaven's like. Hollywood has their own ideas about heaven. And I'm not interested in Hollywood or Hallmark. I'm interested in the Holy Bible. I don't want to just live my life on my own thoughts about heaven. I want to live my life with the truth of heaven in mind. What heaven is really going to be like. And the Bible gives us a glimpse into glory to know some things about heaven. Look, if you will, as we behold more into what John saw in heaven. Heaven is real. It's beyond our comprehension. It's going to be great. We know that. And we've heard about walls of jasper, gates of pearl, a street of pure, transparent gold. We've heard about that. And so the splendor is going to be beyond anything you and I can even imagine or fathom in our minds in this service tonight. But But I would like to give you a few things that the Bible says. Look in verse 5. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices, and there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Now, remember Revelation chapter 4, the church is called up to meet the Lord in the air after chapter 3 concludes. At the beginning of chapter 4, we are raptured before the time of the great tribulation. Now, when the church is raptured, the storm of God's wrath is about to be unleashed. So out of the throne, there's lightnings, and there's thunderings, and there's voices, and Brother Frank, the wrath of God is to its full mark. God's taking the bride out, and he's getting ready to pour out the wrath of God on this world. When we get to heaven, we're going to see the holiness of God in action. As God is going to send tribulation to this world like this world has never known before. The time of Jacob's trouble is still ahead. I believe in stand with Israel. We support Israel. And it warms my heart to say the darkest days for the nation of Israel are still ahead. In that 7-year time period of God's last dealings, that 70th week of Daniel's prophecy, that's going to be the darkest hour they've ever known. I'm going to tell you, after the darkest hour will come the brightest light they've ever seen. When he arises as the Son of Righteousness with him in his wings, and he comes again to rule and reign from Jerusalem. I'm going to say, bless his holy name. I'm glad I got a Bible, and I'm glad you and I are about to check out of this old world. By the means of the rapture, hallelujah. Isn't it wonderful to know that we're going to be with him? So here we see the storm of wrath, the supernatural workings of the Spirit of God are seen. Now look at verse 6. Next we see there's the sea of glass. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. Now take your mind with me and travel back in the Old Testament. When God gave them the tabernacle, God granted them to have the laver in the tabernacle. And of course, the laver was used for the purification of the priest. The tabernacle was set up when he entered into the gate. And the first article there was the brazen altar. The brazen altar is a picture of the cross of Jesus Christ. You'll never get in the Holy of Holies with God if you don't come by the way of the cross through the blood sacrifice. Brass is a symbol of judgment. But after they went through there, the other articles that are mentioned, before you go to the holy place, there's what's known as the laver. The laver was there for the priest. The laver had been used from the looking glasses. I'm glad we got a Bible to look into it. See, before you say by the grace of God, you're just a sinner on your way to hell off without God. But when you get saved by the grace of God, He puts an exclusive ownership on you. You have been bought with a price, and therefore you're to glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. The laver was a place of cleansing for the priest. He would get dirty in the daily ministration and the work that he had, and so he would go there to the laver and he would wash himself and cleanse himself in the service of the Lord. Can I just remind you tonight, you and I still have to be clean. You know how we get clean? Through the Word of God.
Amen.
We look into the Word of God and it reveals us as we really are. A lot of times the Word of God is sharp and quick and powerful and two-edged, because when you peer into this Word, it begins to reveal things about us we didn't even know about ourselves. Amen.
Right.
Well, thank God that I have a Bible tonight. The sign of heaven is this. The labor was there for the purification of the priest. And then, as the development comes in the nation of Israel, they go from the tabernacle until the days of Solomon. God allows Solomon to build the temple. In the temple, it's no longer the labor, but it's known as the sea. It had the same principle. It was for the cleansing of the priest. But now look at this. When you get to the glory world, it's solidified.
It's not got water in it. Solidified. You know why, Brother Frank, it's going to be solidified in heaven? Because there's going to be no need of cleansing anymore.
Right.
have to go before him ever again. Bow at his feet and say, Lord, I'm so sorry that I failed you today. I'm never going to have to acknowledge sin to God again when I'm in that new glorified body. There'll be no need of cleansing. The city in heaven is going to be solidified. It's going to be crystal. Hallelujah. I don't know about you. That sure blesses my heart. Amen. Look on down, if you will. Verse 4, or verse 6 and 7. Then John is identifying these four beasts. And I know commentaries have a variety of ideas about what they are. But I do know this about them. They symbolize the Lord. Look in this verse, if you will. And in the midst of the throne, and round about the throne, were four beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion. The second beast like a calf. The third beast had a face as a man. And the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. I don't know who they are, but I know what the Bible says about them. They're beasts. Some commentaries say there's a type of a seraphim. Some say there's a type of a cherubim. I don't really know, but I know this. The Bible said they're beasts. But I can tell you this about these beasts. They resemble the Lord. Because when you look at how they're unfolding in this passage, you see the first one is the first beast was like a lion. When you study Matthew's gospel is written primarily to the Jews, and it is to portray him as the king of the Jews. He is the lion of the tribe of Judah. Hallelujah. When you come to Mark's gospel, Mark portrays him as a servant of Jehovah. You find words like straightway and forthwith. It is an action gospel. He's serving his father in Mark's gospel. And so Mark presents him as that ox. When you come to that third beast, the face of a man, the gospel of Luke presents Christ as the Son of Man. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, friend, I'm glad he came and he became a man forever so he could save us by the grace of God. When you come to John's gospel, he's the Son of God. That eagle typifies heavenly origin. That eagle's at home in the sky. He can soar like no other beast can. I'm glad, thank God, our Savior came from glory. And he's not only a man forever, but he is God, the eternal Son forever. Amen. Hallelujah. Somebody said, preacher, I can't hardly understand that. Well, I'll tell you this, he's not 50% man and 50% God. No, he's 100% God, while at the same time being 100% man. And my friend, I don't have to understand all that, but I sure believe it all. Because the Word of God tells me. That's how it is. Amen. Well, this is some of the sights in heaven. I'm going to give you this and I'll soon close. In heaven, we see the shouting and the singing. Look down, if you will, at verse 9 through 11 again. We've already read these verses, but in verse 11, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. Thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. In chapter 4 of Revelation, the saints are praising a sovereign God for his work in creation. Think about this. 6,000 years ago, God stepped out on nothing, and by the power of his word, spoke everything into existence. In six literal 24-hour day periods of time, God made it all. You say, well, they didn't teach me that in school. Yeah, they didn't teach you that in school because they've been propagating a theory that's never been proven, and it can't be proven. Yeah, that's right. We made the likeness and image of God, not the likeness and image of the monkey.
Come on.
Amen. Say amen to that.
Amen.
Hey, I've seen a few people that my friend made me question it.
The way they acted. Yeah. I don't understand it. We're made the likeness and image of God.
That's right, brother.
We are unique of all God's creation.
You know what makes us unique to all of God's creation? Because when God made us, he made us body, soul, and spirit.
And when you're lost and unsaved, you don't have a quickened spirit. And when you don't have a quickened spirit, you don't have the ability to commune with God.
But when you get saved by the grace of God and he regenerates your spirit, he gives you that new nature, that new life.
You have the life of God in the soul of men, and you have the ability to commune with God. That sets us apart from all that God made. We're the crown jewel of God's creation.
That's right. In heaven, they're still going to be praising God for what he made, what he did.
really praising him for the new creation as a saving God. Look at what the Bible says very carefully in verse number 9. And they sung a new song saying, Thou art worthy to take the book and open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. And you say, what are you saying, preacher? Well, in chapter 4, they're praising him for the work of creation, but in chapter 5, they're praising him for the work of the cross. Amen. Yeah. Hey, we're never going to get over all that he did, but we're never going to get over how he saved unworthy sinners like you and I. I like that old song, don't you? And they sing from time to time, I know how I made it. I made it by grace. I'm thankful tonight for the good grace of God that's extended to me. And by putting my faith and trust in Christ, repenting of my sin, turning around from a life of iniquity, a life of rebelling and running from God, and ran to Him.
Have mercy with the Lord. Embrace the cross.
God forever changed my life. Say, preacher, what's heaven going to be like? Well, according to chapter 4, chapter 5,
it's going to be shouting and singing. Now, everybody hear me well. We come to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, whenever you meet in the house of God.
You know what God wants church to be like? God wants church to be a dress rehearsal for heaven.
Amen.
He wants Christ
to be pretty. He wants everybody to look at him, reverence him, respect him, honor him, give him glory.
No greater thing can we do in this life than worship God. God made you a worshiper. Everybody worships something or someone.
If you don't believe that, you just watch. It won't take long. You'll find out, man. You travel to some of these coliseums where their favorite football teams play. It can be below zero windshield, snowing on them. They can be sitting there at their fingers, literally freezing off. And their team score a touchdown in that place with their rug. And it will actually pick up on size and scale how loud those stadiums become.
I'm not against sports. I'm not against those things. But I'm going to say this. There's something wrong when we can worship things in the world, but we can't even say amen to church.
Right.
Amen. Amen. Preach on what I'm talking about. I believe you.
Right.
Dress rehearsal for heaven.
Amen.
Listen.
That's good.
What if heaven
was like the average Baptist church service? If it was average Baptist church service, you'd maybe get a little grunt every once in a while. Amen.
Right.
Amen. You'd have half the crowd over here asleep.
Right.
God wants us to be in tune when we come to church. Because you never know, Brother Terry, when you're going to stroll in here and worship Him here the last time.
That's right.
And then the next time you worship Him, it's not going to be here. It's going to be there.
When we get there, I want to be tuned up, don't you? Heard Brother Leonard Fletcher say this years ago. He said, some Baptists will have to take a shouting class before God lets them around the throne. Amen. I ought to be that way.
He ought to get all the glory.
Right.
All the honor, all the praise. Tonight, in closing this message, I'll say this. If you're not sure you're going to heaven, Jesus Christ is the only way.
Amen.
Amen. I like what the sister said a few moments ago.
Dr. Adrian Rogers said years ago that he feared that a many number of his congregation that he'd passed through the years had never been saved. If a man as great as Dr. Adrian Rogers,
one of the greatest Bible students of his day, if he believed that a lot of his church people had saved, then I wonder where we are today. Here's the truth. We saw a lady here just a little while back get her old time conviction, Brother Frank. She got on this side of the altar over here and got gloriously, wondrously, marvelously saved. She had been a member of Scottville Baptist Church 30 plus years. baptize a 75-year-old lady got saved after 30 years of sitting on church.
But here's the difference, sinner. About every time we have church now, if you give her about that much of a window to say something, she'll jump up and say, I want to thank God I got saved. I want to thank God he showed me I was lost.
I want to thank God I realize that's a sinner need to repent and get saved.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God for that. See, the key is,
if she had died, and I had preached her funeral 5 years ago, I would have thought she was in heaven.
And while we would have been in the church service thinking that she was in heaven, she would have literally been in hell at that moment.
So we would have not even known it. Thank God she got saved.
Amen.
Thank God. Hey, it's not my job. It's not anybody's job to tell you you're saved. That's the Holy Ghost job.
I never tell anybody I know you're saved, because I don't know you're saved. Only God knows you're saved. I know I'm saved. You can know you're saved. But I think it's dangerous business to tell somebody they're saved. Let the Holy Ghost do that. Several years ago, this lady got under deep conviction in church. She stepped out and started down an aisle,
and her mama jumped up behind her and grabbed her by the arm and said, you don't need to go, you're saved. You've been a Christian all your life. I've got sad news for you. Ain't none of us been a Christian all our life.
If you can't go back to a time and place that you got arrested by the high sheriff of heaven, got convicted of sin, took Christ as your personal Savior, then I just want to tell you, you can't get to heaven the other way without the way of the cross.
Right.
Have you been saved tonight? You know heaven's going to be your home. Do you know now? If you die tonight, you go to heaven. Boy, it's good to know that, isn't it?
I'll never forget. God dealing with me about getting saved. I was fighting it. Because I was just like this sister talked about.
I was young. I made a confession. I was young. But here's the difference in what I did when I was young and when I really got saved. When I was young, I went to the altar because friends did. But on May 11, 2000, I went to the altar because the Holy Ghost of God convicted me and convinced me I was a sinner. And I knew if I didn't get to God, I was going to end up dying and going to hell.
Those days of conviction, I had a hard time sleeping because I lay down at night. I knew. After God really lit me, Brother Frank, I knew if I don't get saved, I am going to hell. I knew that.
But on May 11, 2000, on that side of the altar, Landmark Baptist Church, I responded to him and I said, Lord, save me. You know what the Lord did? He saved me. Just like I said,
right.
And I went home that night, and for the first time in my life,
I laid down in my bed, Brother Frank, and it was just like laying in cotton.
Yeah.
I laid down, and I closed my eyes,
and it just really dawned on me. If I die today, it's okay.
Yeah.
I know I'm going to heaven.
Amen.
I know
I'm going to heaven. And from that day to this day, I've been on the way. And by the grace of God, his keeping power is what's going to keep me. I'm not keeping myself saved. I couldn't do that. But he's the keeper of my soul.
Right.
And one of these days, I'm going to be whole in that good land. And my prayer is, I want everybody here tonight to be there with me.
Sure.
From the oldest to the youngest, the middle age, I want everybody here tonight to be able to walk out of this field tonight, look us in the eye, and be able to say, I'll sleep there.
Amen.
By the grace of God.
If you couldn't do that tonight, I'd come right now.
Now get that fixed. Brother Terry, you come stand up here tonight. You know you people better than anybody. Stand on our feet tonight. Ask your wife if she'll come. Let's play something softly on the piano. If you're here tonight, you don't know that heaven's going to be your home. It's a good night to give him praise because it is. But if you don't know that it is, not a better night than on this Thursday night to come on and get that thing settled, get saved, where you can know. I wonder how many tonight is in honesty before the Lord. You could lift that hand up and say, preacher, if I died right now, I know I'm going to heaven because Jesus saved me. Can you lift that hand up and say, thank you, Lord? I know I'm going to heaven. So those hands go down. Will there be somebody honest in that and say, preacher, God's dealing with me right now. Because I don't know if I died right now, heaven would be my home. I want you to pray for me, please. There'd be one honest heart in this building and say, God, God bless that hand. God bless that hand. You that raised your hand tonight, would you like to step out and come? I know your pastor would love to meet you right here in this altar. Pray with you. Amen. You just do business with God. You feel God speaking, leading, dealing with you. You come. Call upon the name of the Lord. He's able.
I hope you know that. If you don't know that,
tonight's got a word or a testimony on your heart.
Good time after this.
That'll be good, because I told my kids
thinking, you know, the brother preached on heaven, and she was talking about her daughter getting saved while she was going to get chicken. Now, how much closer to heaven did you get than that? Amen? Listen, a child getting saved and chicken at the same time. There ain't no one. We love them. We appreciate you. Just have a little Tanner, if you wouldn't have come on up here in the front. And then we're going to dismiss this afternoon by giving him a right hand of welcome into the family of God. And, you tell him how much you love him. You come right down here, young man. You tell him how much you love him, how much you're going to be praying for him. Because I know what the devil will do. The devil will do everything he can to try to attack him and just to give him every excuse to not. Listen, young